Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Everything's Amazing, sort of. Written by Liz Pichon and read by Rupert Grint. I'm in a very good mood today for lots of reasons. One, I found more excellent ways to use Delia's sunglasses that she doesn't know about. Armpit scratcher. Smelly sock holder. Bird scarer. Foot scratcher. Two, I ran twice around the garden before my toast popped up, which is a new Tom Gates world record. Three, my toast doodles looked amazing. My toast art, enjoy, especially the one of Delia. And I'm even a bit early for school. Mr. Fullerman looks shocked to see me in class on time. He says, "This is a nice surprise, Tom," and smiles, which doesn't happen very often. Then Marcus pulls a face at me, which does happen a lot. Nice. But nothing can put me in a bad mood today, apart from these two words. Maths lesson. Then it gets worse. Maths lesson with Mrs. Worthington. And worse. Now. I've stopped smiling. Luckily, Amy Porter sits next to me in class and she loves maths. She can't get enough of maths, which is handy for me because this is how much I like maths. Love maths, hate maths, off the scale. So when I get stuck on something tricky, I can take a speedy look at Amy's correct answers, like this. But if I look the other way, like this, all I get is Marcus Mildew's rubbish answers. He's almost as bad at maths as me. But from the way he punches the air and says, "Yes, maths, my favourite," you'd think he was a maths genius. He's not. Then Mrs. Worthing-tash appears. I call her that because she has a slightly furry top lip. Just to be clear, I never, ever say Mrs. Worthing-tash out loud. She announces to the whole class that if we're really good all lesson, we can do her special maths quiz. "It will be such fabulous fun with numbers," she says enthusiastically. I doubt it. Marcus tells Amy, "You can be on my team." Amy looks thrilled. Marcus is behaving like a right twit. He keeps grinning and nodding at everything Mrs. Worthing-tash is saying. "Yes, yes." Ever since Marcus was caught cheating on the Gold Star Award chart, he's been trying to get back into all the teachers' good books. It's sort of working too, because Mrs. Worthing-tash congratulates Marcus on being so wonderfully keen today. He's sitting up straight, looking even more pleased with himself now, if that's possible. Smug. I tell Amy that keen is just another word for irritating, which makes her laugh. Then Mrs. Worthing-tash asks, "Would you like to share your joke with the whole class?" We both keep very quiet, unlike Marcus, who won't shut up. He's got his hand up and wants to know if we'll be doing times table squares today. Groan. Then he says, "I've been practicing a lot, Mrs. Worthington." And Mrs. Worthing-tash says, "Well done for reminding me, Marcus. Yes, we will be doing times table squares today. Is everyone ready?" Nice work, Marcus. Still, it could be worse. At least I get to do a bit of drawing, even if it is just lines and numbers. Here goes. So far, so good. 12 squares this way, 12 this way. I'm busy trying to fill in my square, doing the ones I know first, 2 and 10 times table. Marcus keeps saying, "This is so easy." But I can see that he's made loads of mistakes already. Ha! I take a quick glance in Amy's direction, just to check I'm doing okay. She's nearly finished hers. Then it gets a bit tricky. I have to use my fingers to count on. Doesn't everyone? Marcus starts deliberately counting louder than me, which is really putting me off. I keep losing my place. 10, 2, 15, 4, 20, 6. I've lost my place again. He's driving me bonkers. I can't concentrate with him next to me, being all smug and noisy. 7, 14, 21. It's impossible to write my numbers properly. So I start to doodle instead and draw this. Marcus, noisy and annoying. What lion? Then I do another one. What monster? And another. What spider? One more. What giant boy-eating bird? Mrs. Worthingtash spots Norman Watson leaning back in his chair. She tells him to sit up properly. Then she says, "Now, everyone, put down your pens and listen carefully." Which is a shame because I didn't get to finish this drawing. What ogre? All my times table square. Oh well, I'll fill it all in during the rest of the lesson. I'm trying very hard to pay attention to Mrs. Worthingtash. She is busy teaching the lesson and saying things like, "Count how many dots there are. Then times that by the number of squares. Blah, blah, blah." Mysteriously, my eyelids seem to be getting heavier and heavier and heavier. I force them back open by trying to concentrate on what she's saying. The trouble is, it sounds like she's speaking another language, one I don't understand.
Buggle, buggle, blubble, blubble, oogle, rubble, slubble, wibble, flubble. Wobble, poggle, wobble, flop, loff. Okay?
And to make things worse, Mrs. Worthingtash keeps moving closer and closer to me, so I can see her moustache a bit too clearly for my liking. It's even harder to concentrate now. I find myself staring at the number of hairs she has under her nose and counting them, which is helping me keep my eyes open. I've counted almost 15 hairs when Mrs. Worthingtash asks me, "Are you all right, Tom?" I don't want to be rude or bring attention to the fact that I haven't finished my times table square yet, so I'm very polite and say, "I'm fine, thank you, Mrs. Worthingtash." And she says,
"I'm sorry, Tom. What did you say?"
So I say it a bit louder. "I'm fine, thank you, Mrs. Worthingtash." Did I just say that out loud? From the way Mrs. Worthington is glaring at me, I'm guessing I did. Yep, I did. This might take some explaining. I try my best. Because I have a terrible cold, this sneeze just crept up on me unexpectedly when I said your name like this. Mrs. Worthington. I'm not sure Mrs. Worthington is convinced. Luckily for me, Norman Watson comes to my rescue by falling backwards in his chair again. Now he's waving his legs around in the air, like an upturned turtle, because he's stuck. Mrs. Worthington goes to help him and tells me, "I'll deal with you later, Tom." That doesn't sound good. Later. My maths teacher's name is Mrs. Worthington. Mrs. Worthington. Mrs. Worthington. Tom! Mrs. Worthington. Mrs. Worthington. Mrs. Worthington. Mrs. Worthington. Mrs. Worthingtashton. Mrs. Worthington. Mrs. Worthington. I won't make that mistake again. Out loud. Break time. News travels fast in our school. Everyone seems to know about my moustache mistake. Derek is laughing a lot until I tell him about the lines I had to do and the extra maths homework too, which he thinks is harsh. So to cheer me up, Derek suggests we go and have a game of Champ. It's an excellent idea. Champ is a top game to play for lots of reasons. One, you don't need much stuff. Ball and chalk. Two, it's super fast, so you never get bored. Three, me and Derek are pretty good at Champ. When we get to Champ Corner, some little kids have already drawn out a Champ Square, and are about to start playing. Derek asks if we can join in the game, but they don't seem that keen. I promise we won't hit the ball hard, I say, in case they're worried.
I will, because I'm champ,
the smallest girl says. Derek whispers, she won't be champ for very long. Here are the rules of champ, in case you don't know. It's easy. Rules of champ. It's a bit like cheap tennis. Use your hand to hit the ball, no scooping. Only one bounce allowed, but the ball can go to any of the four squares. To become the champ, you move around the squares. But if you're out, you go to the back of the queue, or to square four, if there's no one waiting. You must try and stay in champ square for as long as possible to become the ultimate champ. Oh, yes! Missed!
Out!
Our mate Solid, who's the tallest boy in the school, wants to join in. The little kids seem okay about it, even though Solid looks like a giant standing next to them. When we start playing, those little kids are a lot quicker than I expect. I've only hit one ball when, pow, I'm out already.
Bad luck. Back of the queue for you,
the girl says. Solid joins in next. He's a bit slow hitting the ball, but not as slow as Derek.
You're out,
champ girl says. Turns out that being as tall as Solid isn't much help reaching the low shots in champ.
Missed.
This puts me back in the game. When Derek joins in, we try hitting the ball. Backwards, and forwards to me, then to me, Derek. It's the only way not to get out. And works well, until I accidentally pass the ball to the champ girl. Then, whack! The ball comes back so fast, I don't even see it go into the corner of my square.
Out again,
the champ girl shouts. This isn't as much fun as I thought it would be. The school bell rings, which saves me from more champ humiliation.
Let's have a rematch at lunchtime,
the little girl suggests. Maybe not. I'm very busy, I say.
Don't worry,
she adds.
Winning won't take long.
Exactly. I'm almost looking forward to going back to class now. Until I remember what my next lesson is. Groan. English with Mr. Fullerman. I think Mr. Fullerman has been chit-chatting with Mrs. Worthing Ton in the teacher's staff room during break. He said what? As soon as I come into class, he says to me, I've been told to keep a special eye on you, Tom. Which is a worry. Mr. Fullerman with his special eye. Marcus has his book open already, and he's busy drawing something that he wants me to look at. What now?
This is you, Tom.
It's me with a moustache. Hilarious, Marcus. You are the funniest boy in the whole school. Not. Just when I think that today's lesson is going to be worse than that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.